here's the build up. Are we ready? Getting ready to start? Welcome. Happy Easter. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yes, he has, and we're glad you are here to celebrate it. It's great to see you. We have a few family members that are in Florida visiting other family members and celebrating Easter there, so we have a couple of fill-ins today. And we're glad that you're here to sing and raise our voices together in praise. Let's do that. And if you can, stand with us as we begin today.
Saved. Hallelujah.
Step down from glory
Pastor begins to preach. Oh, Lord, I could just stand here all day and just say hallelujah and thank you, Lord. Because, Lord, it was nothing that I had to do or we had to do. Lord, it was all done by you. It is called the gift of salvation. And, Lord, we just want to take this time to just praise you for the awesome and mighty God you are. Thank you for your love and mercy that you shower upon us. And Lord, I just pray for Pastor as he begins, Lord, that you would fill him with your Holy Spirit, that he may speak the words that you want to be spoken today, that everyone here would know that they are loved by you and that they can become a child of yours if they aren't already. And we thank you and you praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much. Luke chapter 24 is where we're going to be landing today in our passage for this Easter resurrection morning celebration. Let me read a selection. These are sort of the highlight reel passages from Luke 24. Rather than reading that entire chapter. This starts at verse 1, chapter 24 of Luke. I'm reading from the NIV, and we are at the tomb in this particular highlight. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Then we skip to the road to Emmaus and two other witnesses, verse 30. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. Then we find ourselves in Jerusalem in a room where the disciples are waiting and Jesus appears among them. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace be with you. Look at my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. Then we're moved over to the Mount of Transfiguration. And while he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Let's pray together as we dive into this passage. Lord, we're asking today for a whole lot more than just an Easter basket of sweet spiritual analogies. We want more than a good story that inspires. We're asking today for you to show up powerfully in your word and for your spirit to quicken that word in our hearts. We're asking you to shout to us so it's unmistakable and clear and life-changing. We're asking you to breathe new life into those who are dead in their sin, and we're asking you to do what you do best by surprising us with joy as we realize what it is you've done for us because of your great love expressed through your death on a cross on our behalf. Thank you for all you've done for us. We celebrate the victory over sin and death because of the resurrection. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let me set the stage by letting you know that the disciples experienced something that was far bigger than the little story I'm going to share with you, but you get a little sense of the feeling they had. Way back in college, we're going more than 40 years ago now, we had a funeral at the church next to the college, which was a tough one for all of us because it was for our college president, Dr. William Hinsey. His son Richard was going to give the eulogy. Dr. Hinsey died, unfortunately, while doing a pickup game of basketball with some faculty members and a bunch of students in what was then a little gym on campus. And he was that kind of a guy. He would just mingle and mix with the rest of the students. People knew him well. He would have conversations with them on the quad and see how things were going for them. And he died so suddenly that way. A guy who had just really lived out his convictions, his biblical convictions. He had done mission work with his family in Brazil before coming to Grand Canyon. He was a brilliant guy, a wonderful academician, so intelligent. He could preach from a Greek New Testament text and translate on the fly. He was just so smart. And so it was a shock to all of us on campus when Dr. Hinsey passed away. So his younger son, he had a couple of sons. His youngest son, Richard, who was studying to go into the ministry, was tapped to give the eulogy for his father. So he's still in college. He's still studying. He's still green around the gills. And a lot of us were thinking, well, I don't know if I could do that. And so we were praying for Richard because we knew that this was tough on him. Joy and I were attending the church, First Southern Baptist Church of Phoenix there, right next to the college. And our pastor, Gary Young, was really supportive. And he loved students, and he was loving this student and tried to help him prepare as best he could. He said, now, Richard, your training is going to kick in. The Holy Spirit gives you the power you need the minute you need it, so trust him. But just in case the emotions get the best of you, I'm going to be seated real close to you. And all you have to do is just nod at me if the throat gets choked up and you can't continue. And I know you've got your eulogy all written out. So if that happens, you just come and take my place in the seat, and I'll stand up and I'll read the eulogy. It'll be okay. Well, Richard stood up there, and he stood and looked out over this standing room only crowd. The auditorium sat 600, and there were way many more people in there that day. The fire marshal would have had a fit. And he stood there and looked at us, and he looked for a long time. It felt awkwardly long. And I wondered if he was trying to gather enough strength to be able to continue and get those first words out. And then he finally spoke. And when he did, it was profound and it was powerful. And he said, my dad is not dead. And a whole bunch of us went, uh-oh. I don't know. And I looked over at Dr. Gary to see if he was, you know, his eyes were a little bit wider than normal, but he wasn't jumping up to go take Richard's place yet. And we all held our collective breath. I don't think anybody in that auditorium breathed for at least another 10 seconds after that, because we're thinking, what's going to happen next? And then he said, he is more alive now than he's ever been, and he's enjoying the life that he looked forward to ever since the day he gave his heart and life to Jesus Christ. And we all just kind of went, oh, okay, there's a little breath we can take now. Whew, that was good. That's kind of what the disciples experienced, but a lot bigger and over a longer period of time, starting all the way with this arrest and the mock trials and the flogging and the crucifixion, the agonizing crucifixion, and then the burial. And then nothing happened, and that Saturday was so quiet. And then Easter came, and the sun came up, and the sun came up. Luke 24 is the gospel we're looking at because it shows all four of these big resurrection appearances that happened that help confirm some things for us. And it's like Dr. Luke is organized. And Luke is the guy who wrote it, and he organizes the chapter into four easily recognizable parts, these outlines for us. And it's verse 1 through 12. Jesus is no longer in the tomb. That's the appearance when the women get to the tomb first because they were bringing the spices. And they look in, and it's empty. And then they had to run back and tell the other guys. And then there's verses 13 through 35, where Jesus appears to these two guys on the road to Emmaus, who were so grief-stricken, they didn't even recognize who they were speaking with until they got to the house, and they invited him in, and he broke the bread, and they recognized him. And then verses 36 through 49, where he appears just suddenly among them in a room of people in Jerusalem, these disciples, and started talking with them in person. And then we have the Mount of Transfiguration appearance, where he's up there blessing his disciples and telling them some of the things he wants them to know just before God takes him up and he ascends into heaven in front of their watching eyes. So rather than looking at the forest by looking tree by tree in sort of an exegetical verse-by-verse look at this chapter, we would be here until Tuesday if we did that. So we're not going to look at that this time. We're going to look at the four major themes that are threaded through here in this tapestry of chapter 24. And those four themes are: this was a paradigm-shifting event. Cataclysmic, shattering, paradigm-shifting event. Secondly, the resurrection is a key to unlocking all the other scriptures. And third, a powerful message for others, including those starting with Jerusalem and going literally all around the globe. That's what this resurrection is. And finally, it's proof that Jesus is King. It's a paradigm-shifting, real-life historical event. Paradigm shifts occur when something big and tangible and witnessable happens, and enough people are moved by it that it changes wide perceptions. Like when I found out that Mexican food is actually good. Because when I was young, I didn't like anything spicy, and I would think, ah, that's too spicy, I don't like that. And then all of a sudden, one day, it was just like the light switch went on, and I had some enchiladas, pollo enchiladas, it was so muy bien. And it was so spicy, but it was so good, it was like my taste buds had grown up. And I realized, this is a paradigm-shifting event, I can't get enough Mexican food now. Or like when some sailors found out firsthand that they did not, in fact, fall off the flat earth as they sailed toward the horizon, and that changed everything in a perception of what our actual globe looks like. Looks like a globe. When big things happen with tangible, observable evidence, consequences, it changes people's perceptions. And man, I tell you what, this one split history in half. That's how big it was. Now, there are a lot of people. You can go on the internet. I don't advise it, but you could. And you could find a lot of people who try to turn even Luke 24 into a series of really lovely analogies and stories about there's life, new life in spring that comes like up like the flowers in your garden, the perennials. Or this is something that can motivate you to turn over a new leaf. Now's the time to paint that room you've been putting off. And they can have all the nice little analogies that you come up with. But let me state just very clearly, I want you to hear it from my own mouth. I do not believe this is just a series of analogies. This is no metaphor. This is a life-changing, paradigm-changing event that happened in enough real time with real witnesses and real consequences for these folks that it really happened. In fact, all you have to do is read chapter 24 and you think, how do people come up with the fact that they think this is just metaphoric? How do you do that? This is not the way people write when that happens. I mean, Jesus appears to a bunch of his closest disciples, and he's saying basically, and I'm paraphrasing here, hey guys, look at me. Look to me, my eyeballs. Look at me. Touch me. Touch my hands. You can see where the nails went in. Look at my feet. Touch my side. Let's have something to eat. I see you're broiling some fish there. This is a real life experience with a guy who's saying ghosts don't have bodies like this. And this happened. I think there's a whole lot more going on here in these eyewitness events than just a bunch of people saying, well, there's some good metaphor here with Jesus having some broiled fish with his buddies. It's very different than that. It's like he's saying, hey, guys, I am not a myth. Amen. I'm not a concept in your mind. I'm real. I'm God the Son who came to earth in the incarnation, and I died, and I'm alive again, and I'm here with you. I'm real. And there are many eyewitnesses. At the tomb, you've heard this if you've been to church every Easter for the last 12 years. You're welcome back next Sunday as well. Sorry, ladies, this is not meant to demean you, but if you have been around long enough, you probably are aware that women were not credible sources as eyewitnesses back then. Their witness account would not even hold up in court. And yet, what does Luke write? He says the first persons to see that empty tomb were women. Isn't that something? I'm grateful for that. Now, why would he write that in there if they were not credible witnesses? Well, because it happened. He just wrote it the way it is. Jewish people were deeply entrenched. You know, you've probably seen Fiddler on the Roof or know about it. You know, tradition. They were deeply entrenched in their traditions and in their religious milieu. The big word for that. It was their subculture, and it was strong, and they didn't deviate from that. There were certain things they had to keep doing the same way over and over again, and they were the last people on the planet that you would expect to embrace a paradigm-shifting thing like happened with the resurrection. And yet here we are. We're getting people in the Gospels like Luke who are writing about them, Jews, formerly Jews. They're still Jews in their minds, but they're worshiping, and they're worshiping a man. The people who wouldn't even say the name of God out loud prior to this event. And even today, many will spell it G dash or hyphen D. They won't even write out the name of God. And here they are worshiping and saying, oh, we've seen him. This is real. He's the fulfillment of all those prophets that are in our scriptures. This is a paradigm shifting event. This kind of major shift in the worldview happened quickly. It doesn't happen over decades like sometimes happens if somebody writes an outlier book and a few disciples of that person pick up the book and they read it and they go, ooh, you should read this book too. It's really amazing. These are great principles in here. These are some life-changing things. And they pass the book around until finally it starts to catch on. And decades later, that person has an influence on somebody else. This is not like that. This is instantaneous. This resurrection of Jesus is literally overnight. And it's such a big deal that people can't keep their mouth shut about it. They weren't preaching, I was there at the empty tomb. I was there on the Mount of Transfiguration. I'm here to preach you a really useful analogy. Doesn't come out that way. It says, we saw the real Jesus, and he's alive, and he's alive today, and he can change you too. That's why this caught on so quickly. People actually underwent some unusual consequences for preaching that particular message, in fact. They would say, go ahead, take me to jail, I don't care. You can try to make us not speak about this stuff, but we can't not speak about this stuff. It happened. It's so life-changing that we're going to talk about it regardless of what you do with us. Put us in jail. We'll sing praises at midnight. This is how it changed people. I think it would be wise to, because I'm always aware of different audiences when I'm speaking these kinds of truths. And I know that there are a lot of skeptics in the world today, a bunch of them. And I think we can cut some of our skeptical friends a little slack by saying, I understand this is a big story for them to swallow. Here's this guy who allegedly was God at one time. He gave all that up. He came to earth in the form of a baby, born in a manger, and he lives a sinless life. And they're thinking, who lives a sinless life? And then he's framed. He dies a cruel criminal death on a cross for something he didn't do, and he's buried in a tomb, and then 3 days later he actually rises again. Yeah, right. You can see why some people are skeptical. This is a big deal. And yet, that's why we have to keep going all the way back to the point of this. It is the cross at the center of the truth of the gospel, which appears for us, and it makes everything else make sense. The resurrection is something that just has to be dealt with. If Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, then why even worry about the other parts of the Bible? We can just chuck it in the bin, throw it out. There are some people who say, well, I just don't want to embrace that story because I would have to embrace these other stories as well. And there are some of these things that are very offensive to me in the Bible. And if you push on that a little bit and say, well, are you saying that the resurrection of Christ, that part of the Bible, is offensive to you? They might say, A, well, no, I just don't believe it ever happened because I don't like those other parts of the Bible, so I'm writing the whole thing off. Or they might say, well, no, that one doesn't really offend me, but I just don't want to have to take the whole thing. But here's the thing. You look at somebody like Paul. He was deeply offended by what these new believers were talking about. So much so, he was having them arrested. He was persecuting the believers who were starting to follow this Christ who was alive again, and were telling that to everybody. And he was terribly offended by that. He wanted to do away with them, in fact. And then he encounters this conversion. And guess who he's speaking about now? This Christ, who's showing me how to live such a better life, and he completely walks away from all that stuff that was legalism and starts embracing grace and writing about it in the book of Romans for us. That's a pretty big paradigm shift. He's a great example of that. Now, let me talk about this next point quickly and succinctly. I'm going to get right to the point. So do it already, you say. In addition to the fact that the resurrection is a paradigm-shifting event, the resurrection is also the key to unlocking Scripture. I've talked to you about how you get mic cords that have a way of turning themselves into spaghetti over time. And if you're trying to unlock that mess, you have to find out where that one part is that just seems to be the magic part. And once you find it, then you start to take that apart, and everything else starts to come apart, and it makes sense. Then it gets all straightened out. And that's the way it is with the resurrection. The resurrection is the key to unlocking Scripture. All these Old Testament Scriptures that foretold what Jesus was supposed to be, who he was going to be like, this Messiah, the suffering servant, all these things in the Old Testament point to him like a neon sign with a great big red arrow going, bleep, bleep, bleep. It's Jesus. It's pointing to Jesus. He's the Messiah. See him? He's coming. Here he comes. And then there's the resurrection, and some people are going, I wonder who he is. He says to his own disciples what the Scriptures had said about him. He said, this is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And every time he starts to expound on the Scriptures themselves, the disciples start to remember and they start to get it. Like those two guys on the road to Emmaus, and they think, why didn't we remember all that stuff while we were talking with him? Duh. Now it makes sense. The penny drops. Boom. When people ask me, where should I start in reading the Bible? I've had some people ask me that over the years. I would say, don't start in Genesis and go all the way from the left to the right. Start in the Gospels. I say Mark is a great one because it's action-packed. It's the briefest of the four. And you can get the whole biography in just a very easy read. And once you start with that, then the rest of the wires start to untangle. And if you start to work your way out into other portions of the Scripture, you go, oh, Jesus is referencing this. Oh, Jesus is quoting from that. Look at how many times the New Testament is filled with Old Testament things because it all ties together. It all makes sense because of the resurrection. Well, another theme in Luke 24, not only is it a paradigm-shifting event, and not only is it the key to unlocking Scripture, but the resurrection is a powerful message. And it's a powerful message that we can share with other people, and it goes all the way over around the world. I was so ecstatic this morning when Jack showed me a picture on his phone of somebody he used to work with, and he said, you recognize this guy who's standing next to him? It's Pastor Prediston, where some of our folks were speaking with him and ministering with him down in the DR just recently. Small world, isn't it? Because the gospel is being carried all around the globe into all these other nations and languages. Recent news, you probably have heard this. Cargo ship hits Baltimore Bridge. Bridge collapses. Now, I had several meetings with people that day, and within hours of the event, everybody that I first saw, they would say, Have you seen the footage of the bridge? That was the first thing out of their mouth. We started talking about that bridge because it was a catastrophic event. And you think, oh my goodness, all that, the force of a rocket launch to have that much weight, you know, when it's going forward, there's something about Newton's laws that coming in contact with something else. It's got to give way to something, and that whole bridge gave way. Well, Jesus' resurrection was even more powerful than that cargo ship. It was huge. Nobody kept it to themselves. You can't keep news like that to yourself. The women at the tomb running back to the guys. Peter and John have to have a foot race to the other one. They have to still vie with each other. One says, well, I got there first. Well, I looked inside first. Read the other Gospels. It's a great account. I probably don't have to tell you this, but when somebody rises from the dead, it's pretty big news. It's a big deal. It's the kind of news that just has to be shared with others, and that's what we see happening in these resurrection appearances. And it's because it means at least three things. First of all, that resurrection means that our future will last forever. We're not just worm food when we die. It's not just one and done. We've got this one life. Make it count. Do all that we can with it, because once you're gone, you're gone. That's not what Christianity is showing us, and that's not what we see because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because he's proof that we go on. It goes on forever. And when we accept the grace of God in our lives, he has such good things in store for us that he promises to us. That kind of hope for a future is big news. Secondly, our future will be personal. We're not just going to melt into everything. There are certain religions that will say we just kind of melt into all the rest of everything and we cease to become ourselves after that, and then we just have this sort of eternal bliss. Christianity doesn't say that. The resurrection of Jesus shows that we are personal and people recognize people after they are resurrected. He's like the down payment on our resurrection, those of us who are in Christ, and so we can look forward to that as well. People are going to recognize each other. It's going to be a better body than the one we've got, but it's going to be a body that's recognizable. We had a good discussion about that in our small group just last Thursday night. We're not sure how that's all going to take place, but man, I'm glad it's going to be better than the one I got now. Third, our future has been paid in full. The resurrection is the proof of purchase. We know from the Bible that the wages of sin is death. That's the one curse that needed to be reversed. And only one person has the ability to do that. He's the only one whose bank account is filled with enough morality and holiness to be able to do that. And that was Jesus Christ. So he paid it in full. And his resurrection is the receipt. Sometimes Joy and I will go to get some extra steps in. And we'll go to TJ Maxx up on Carpenter Road. And we'll walk around. Occasionally, she will actually buy something. I like those shopping sprees where you don't actually buy anything. Those are great. We got a lot of good steps in today, honey. Didn't spend a dime. But we're walking around, and sometimes she'll see, oh, this is on sale. And I say, good, let's get that one. And so she'll get a top, and she'll buy it and puts it in the TJ Maxx bag. But you want to make sure that you get the receipt in there, because sometimes we have to park so far out in the parking lot that we don't want to carry the bag all the way out there, because goodness knows if we're out to get steps, you don't want that many steps. And so you have to walk down the sidewalk to Home Goods because it's just right next door, and you can walk in with your TJ Maxx bag into Home Goods. But you want the receipt just in case that plainclothes security guard person walks up and says, excuse me, sir, but would you show me what's in your bag? You say, yes, it's a lovely top. Don't you think it goes with my shoes? And then he would say, well, do you have a receipt to show that that's been paid for? And I'd go, yes, I do. See, this is, it's proof of purchase. Well, guess what? Jesus Christ gave us a proof of purchase. Amen. And it was so big that he holds it up for the whole world to see. And he says, the wages of sin have been paid for. And I paid for it. Fourth, I said three things. Let's go for four. The resurrection means that our future exceeds what we lost. It doesn't just make up for what we lost. It exceeds that. It goes far beyond what we could even expect or think or imagine when God gets ready to bless our socks off and beyond. Dennis only has one, but that's okay. Here's what it means for those who trust Christ. You get far more than just what you lost on earth. Far more than that. For one thing, you don't just get your old body back, as I mentioned. You're going to get a much better one. The perishable has been replaced by the imperishable. Right. Revelation shows us no more dying, no more tears, no more sadness like that. All that perfection that God created in the beginning, the way it was intended to be, is going to be completely restored. And he's not just saying, okay, well, here, I'm going to pay you back exactly what you lost. You know, I got messed up one time and bought some tickets online from a place that was a cloned website. I was so mad. I threw a book down on the ground. But we were able to get our money back. We were able to prove that they did not give what they had promised us, and so it was considered fraud. The bank went after them. They put it back on my credit card. I got exactly back what I had spent on something that was not right. So anything bad that's happened to you on earth, when you get to heaven, they're not going to keep a little tally sheet and say, okay, well, I saw that you broke your leg in fifth grade, and I'm sorry about that, but here's a nice healed leg, so now we're even. It's not going to say, you missed out on this thing because you got sick just before you were supposed to go to that concert. We're going to send you to the concert so you get to experience that again. Now we're even. No, it's going to be a whole new world lived purposefully. And it's going to be in God's presence, and you're going to be able to think and interact, and you get all these good things. It's going to go so much more than you think of. We're not sitting on clouds playing harps. Amen. That's our eternal future. Far more than we can even imagine. Because of the resurrection of Christ. And then we see that fourth theme in Luke 24. Jesus is king. That's what it proves. That's what the resurrection proves for us. Look at what happened immediately after people saw the resurrected Jesus. The Bible says, and they worshiped him. Everybody serves somebody or something. We all do. Who do we serve? We all need somebody who is the rightful king, and Jesus shows us through the resurrection he's the rightful king. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. There's none like him. He's the one we want to serve. He's the most loving and the most powerful king imaginable. And both his grace and mercy show up together on the cross. They kiss together on the cross. I want to serve a king like that. I want a guy who's all about justice. And I'm all about a guy who's all about love, and those two match perfectly in Jesus Christ. He does them both. You can't imagine the good things he has planned for you, and when you start following that king because he loves you so much, he loves you enough to accept you right where you are, starting right now, and he loves you too much to leave you there. And so he's going to continue to pour his spirit into your life so that we become the clay moldable in his hand, so that he's going to make us more and more into his image, so that more and more people will see Christ in us. That's how much he loves you. So it's not just punching your ticket to get to heaven. It's following this King of Kings through the rest of your life, because why would I not want to obey what he's telling me I should do when I know that he'll never tell me to do something that's going to harm me or somebody else? Everything he wants me to do is for my eternal benefit. I want to serve a king like that. Because of the resurrection, we all know with eyewitness credibility, beyond a doubt, that we can trust this king. And I would say, on a resurrection day celebration, if you have not taken that step of faith, if you have not said, I want to trust Jesus as king, I would say, please, please do it. I would urge you, trust this king. It'll be worth it. And you can do something simple with the ABCD. You can acknowledge that you're a sinner, that you need forgiveness, that you need that kind of king. You can believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and then confess with your mouth that, yes, I believe he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I need him. I want him. And then D, dive into scriptures and do what the scriptures say. Simple as that. And I'll give a little sample prayer if you would like to take that step. And you could say something quietly or in your own mind like this to take that step. Dear God, I acknowledge that I do need a king like that. I need what the pastor's talking about. I need Jesus. I want him to guide my life and to give me a life filled with purpose, so that my identity is wrapped up in him and not in all the other places I've tried to place my identity, because that's falling short for me. I want Jesus to become my focus. I want to fix my eyes on him, since he's the author of my faith, and I know he'll be the finisher of that faith. And I do believe, from all these eyewitness accounts, that he rose from the dead. And I confess that. And I confess my sin to you, asking you for forgiveness. I confess I need Christ. Help me to dive into your word, to start being quickened in my spirit by your Holy Spirit because of those words that change me. And I want to start hanging out with other people who are doing the same thing because we're on the same path together. Thank you for doing all that for me. Thank you for saving me and lifting the weight of sin off my shoulder. I thank you and I praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. It's a happy day when people finally get to that place and they understand what Jesus did for us. And sometimes we need reminders because life gets tough and we kind of go through the slog, and we need days like today to remind us that we're still in the midst of some happy days, and let's celebrate that. I would invite you to join us in singing about that kind of happy day as we go out singing today.
Than the day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. And it is God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Have a very blessed day.